Hello everybody, welcome back to this is the beginning of the next episode. It is Friday, July 8th, 2016, and our timestamp is, well, set this way, so that you'll understand it better. It is 19 hours and 8 minutes into the day of Friday, July 8th, 2016. And we're on the road again. We're doing our peripatetics today. And I figured we could do this as a one-shot video. Well, not only one shot, but a one-day video. We could talk on the way there and talk on the way back and have enough content that'll be basically one vlog. I should say one episode. And that's kind of the goal. Tripod's a little loose, and as I switch back and forth between hands, because the hand gets tired, and it bobbles up and down. yeah, it's not a bad day, actually. It's when you choose to go walking, it's better to walk in the evenings or in the mornings when it's cooler out. It's about 82 degrees Fahrenheit, but there's a nice breeze. So, and the sun has more or less gone down to a certain degree that there's enough cloud overhead that you don't have sunlight directly beating down on you. Where if you went midday, you know, between noon and midday, which is just about 6 o'clock in the evening, it'd be too hot. So, that's the thing, or a thing, and I gotta make more tea tonight. I'm out of tea, again, so, I have to make another 9 liters, and, you know, it's an interesting jaunt. I'm also trying to remember what I was supposed to talk to you guys about, because I had the idea list in my mind sort of molded over just about a half hour before I started vlogging, you know, as I was packing up and getting ready to go. I put together a short list of things we can discuss. And on that short list, is I've begun to connect more of the institute's channels, including the university channel, to this one. That's why now you'll start seeing stuff for INN on Internet News Network. That's INN. You'll see stuff for Academia University TV. We can discuss that here in the BTS vlog. Look at the BTS vlogs. That's said, they're ad hoc notes. They're my research notes. They're the general note that kind of get refined later on and into more specific categories and eventually into more detail as we move along. So this is kind of what's happening here. We're sort of reshaping these things. I'll also be working on the description down below to put in a sort of a time index of where things are. So You can sort of skip ahead and decide to watch whatever you want to watch. If you don't want to watch the full thing, then, you know, the full half hour, that's too much for you. That's fine. You can sort of pick and choose what you want to see, what you want to hear. Yeah, as I said, I am a scientist. This is sort of responding to some comments that were on my video. Not my video. What happens is that I have a number of videos out there. People comment on them, and it's still you still get the sort of response from some people that I'm fat, I'm ugly, so on and so forth, and they comment on my place, and well, yeah, it's not the neatest because, well, I work where I live, I live where I work, and that's kind of the thing, is that physics, the research that I'm doing here, is so time consuming, if you watch enough of these vlogs, you kind of figure it out, that one, there's no time to go home, there's no time to have, I mean, I do have a house at my parents' house, right? And I'm just like 10 minutes away from them. But, there's no time to go home. You know, more often than not, 95% of my time I'm here at, you know, doing research. That's what I do. And the thing is research isn't kind of 9-to-5. It's a lot more involved than that. It's whenever you get an idea and you start thinking about it, you can't stop thinking about it. You have this sort of obsessive view that when you start working on a project, that you have to go as far as you can before you stop. Because you know that things will fall off again, and you may not find the information or have the ideas that you have in terms of understanding the various different problems for a while. So you work as much as far as you can go, as much energy as you have. You work to make sure that you get your work done. Well, it's not, again, this is not a finality. You're not getting to the end of the project. You're simply getting to a point where you can stop and it'll be all right. You wouldn't have lost any information. And that's what I mean, is because you forget things. I mean, everybody forgets things. It's not that we always have the super memory and you remember all the specific details. You don't. I mean, this has been shown. You work in the moment. And that moment could be any time. You could be asleep, you could be dreaming of something. I lucid dream, so I remember what I dreamed, so if I wake up and I had a dream about how to resolve something, or there was a real resolution in my dream, you get up and you start working. You write things down, you sit down, you start figuring things out, you go, you know, you take your notes, and if you can, you go back to bed. If not, because a lot of times you'll end up finding things, or searching for something. I'm coming here to cross. And you'll end up finding more stuff, and again, you think, oh yeah, it's going to be short, it's going to be short. I'll be done in no time. Let's see, it was pretty short. I've got to cross the street here. I'm waiting for the lights. But because people sort of go through the light here, they approach the light very quickly, they don't stop in time. You gotta wait and make sure the cars are stopped and that they see you before you kind of cross. This is the dangerous point here I'm crossing. There's no cars here at the stop sign, at the lights. And so, I hear they come now, someone outside. That's what I might have already crossed. But some of them go past the line, they're going fast enough that they don't stop in time. And this is where that danger comes in, that you have to watch for these things. You have to have an eye out for it. Now, what I did was a little dangerous, but because I was vlogging, but I was aware of what was going on. I had an eye out for it. And so, while the danger was there in no greater degree because I was vlogging than if I wasn't vlogging. So, but normally, when I cross streets, the camera's off, I'm not vlogging. And I cross normally. Yeah. I'm on the next, I'm gonna get on to the next topic. I can't remember what I was talking about before. It's kind of left my mind. I think, the 9-to-5 bit. Being a scientist isn't 9-to-5, particularly if you're a private scientist. It's always in your mind. You're always thinking about it, and it's sometimes it's that 5-minute search that you're going to do in the middle of the night that you woke up and said, okay, I want to take a look at something here. Sort of, what you get in your brain, what you get in your mind is an idea, and you have to sort of meet out this idea to see, is there other research on this that will sort of either directly or indirectly confirm this? So you go out and you take a look, basically on Google, is your beginning part, and you put together an initial assessment enough so that you can get to bed or go back to bed and continue when you get up. But sometimes, particularly if you find actually good information on this, that's kind of, and I know this, sometimes you'll find the information, you'll bookmark the site, you go back to the site, and the site's gone. Why? Because that information's been put up temporarily. It's kind of supposed to be hidden information nobody's supposed to know about. And there's a lot of that around. And so there is that in the back of your mind. So you say, well, if you find a site that's kind of rare, it's not a popular site, then you need to get concerned whether or not that website's going to be there or not. So what you do is you take your information, you mark everything down. If you can, you sort of record the website. And I have a variety of methods I can do that with. And you put it into your library. Right? You put it with a note beside it. Work on this particular note here, whatever stuff that you're talking about, whatever thing you're working on. And you move on to the next one. And usually, in a good search, about 20 minutes into it, I'll have close to 30 to 40 sources, if not more. And that's where the problem comes. You have your sources, you have them sort of, you know which ones you want to go to, and you go through them one by one. And as you go through them, you try to figure out what information is good and what information is bad. And you do that simply by taking your notes. Because you'll go back to it later on as you bookmark it or as you put it into your library, you go back for a second reference. That's the website. These are ad hoc notes. So you do your generals, you do your ad hoc, you go back, you do a second reference. But the thing is, before you finish, that 5 minutes you thought now expands into a full 8 hours, and more often than not, you're not going back to bed again until it's like noon. And there goes your sleep schedule. And this is what happens to me on a repeated basis. I completely lose and miss out on my sleep schedule. Simply because I've been working on a project, doing the research, and before I finished, the so-called 5 minutes later, just like on a video game, it's like noon. You haven't slept yet. People say, I ask gamers, well, how can you go all night long without sleeping? Simple, the focus is such that everything around you disappears, and your sense of time as well. You think you've been on there for 5 minutes, but in reality, you've been on there for hours. It's now noon, and you haven't slept yet. So that's kind of where things are. This is what the life of a scientist is like, particularly if you're doing exploration. And that's what I'm doing. I'm doing open exploration of the universe. Anything and everything in the universe, I explore. There are no boundaries or limits because I'm a private scientist. So I don't have the money for large facilities. I make do with what I have. So in many cases, one room but used for multiple purposes. And that's, where a lot of people see me earlier on. When my research desk was in an area where my electronics bench was, the music studio was there, and so was my laundry. So a lot of times, when I'd vlog, The laundry would be hanging behind me. But I think that's the way it is. That's it. This is a reality show. Right? You want to see behind the scenes. Well, that's behind the scenes. You know, that's the stuff they don't show you on regular documentary. If you want to, onto the Discovery Channel or PBS, and you watch a documentary from there, that's a science documentary, you're not going to see this. You're not going to see the nitty-gritty details. You're not going to see how long a scientist has been working on a project in order to get that final result, to get to the documentary. You don't know how long they've been working on that documentary. Most documentaries take a good 6 months, that half hour, the hour you're watching. That documentary could have taken 6 months to a year to finish. Between the filming, getting the right shots, reshooting things, editing it. Not a simple process. But all that ends up on the cutting room floor. You never see it. Because most people find it boring. And I guess to some degree it is. And, you know, here you see everything. Daily Vlog gives you a chance to see everything in bits and pieces at a time. So anyways, I think that's going to be it for now. I will talk to you on the way back. And we'll continue our discussions on. We'll probably go back into review some of the stuff on the history of socialism. All right. See you on the way back. Well, hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Big Bang Theory House BTS vlog. This is the second segment, and probably the last one. We're going to have our discussion now, and before I forget, let's have a time and date stamp. Because every segment is important to have that in there. That's just how the scientific vlog works. Think of it for those Star Trekky fans. And it's your star date log entry. So it is 19 hours and 55 minutes into the day of Friday, July 8th, 2016. I just finished food shopping, so that's a good thing. I got what I needed, and when I'm on budgets like that, I'm on a rather restricted budget. There are a lot of repairs were needed this year, so in order to do the repairs, the food budget needed to go on a significant restriction. In other words, you only get what you need and nothing more. I should be back in a surplus by September, so we'll see what ends up happening. But the thing is, being on a restricted budget does not mean I don't eat well. Thank God that I'm living in a Asian neighborhood, and most of these immigrants here, even though they don't have a lot of money, eat very well. So I'm happy for that, thankful for that. So I guess I could say every day is both a Thanksgiving Day and a Boxing Day all rolled into one. It appears that the light is better from here. So I'll try to keep that in mind as I vlog. See, so what happens when the light goes into the center, because the sun is behind me now. Or the brightness is behind me. What happens is, I should correct this, because I'm walking west. The sun is more or less already in a setting position, but there's clear sky behind me. And there's darker clouds over here. So it's brighter in many ways behind me. So when I change the camera to the other direction, for some reason, the light is still coming through the clouds and picks everything up. You can see, as I turn it this way, right? This is now darker. My image is darker. Why? Because the background is lighter. When I go this way, foreground now, behind the camera is lighter, background is darker. This is the light, how the light sensor works in the camera. So, I'm going to take a brief pause here while I cross the street. You can watch with me. Let me get the proper pan. And we are now crossing the street together. There are no cars in either direction. Nothing behind me. So you move ahead. You don't stop and wait. You never know when it's going to be filled again. So we're now on the other side. This is the first mall. This is the closest mall to me. But TNT is in here. They don't have a major supermarket in here, so I go to the other one. That's just a little further away from me. The one where TNT is at. Love that supermarket, by the way. So we cross the street. And this brings us into, and we're talking about here, we're talking about the mind of a socialist here, right? So we do go into some of the history of socialism that ends up producing the mind of a socialist. Now, many people who take their bikes, particularly downtown and the West, they talk about bike lanes and so on and so forth. Now, notice, I'm not on a bike. I'm not a cyclist. I was in the former years. But I am a hiker. I don't have a car. I walk everywhere. This is why we have our peripatetics. So, but the difference is, I'm not a socialist. I'm an individualist. And an individualist, it's not a selfish thing. It's belief in that you can do things for yourself. And where you can, you help others. That's the fundamental belief of an individualist. And the thing is that there's no one above me as an individualist. There's no, and also no one below me. No kings above, no serfs below. That's the fundamentals. But in socialism, that's not the view. The view, the standard view that's taught in socialism is one of a minion society. That you have masters above you to whom you obey and pledge allegiance to. These masters, the intellectuals, tell you what to think, how to think, and what to say. This is why you hear at a lot of these rallies, the protest rallies, everybody's chanting. What are they chanting? What are they singing about? Right? Well, that's indoctrination. Then they're learning their lines. They're repeating phrases that somebody has taught them. In other words, they're parrots, they're pawns, they're minions. The mind is absent. And this crowd, the mass, or as Sigmund Freud called them, the bewildered herd, is being herded by the herdmaster. And the herdmaster is a political figure and an intellectual within that society that everybody else looks up to as an authority for truth and understanding. And this is why, to a socialist, education is so important. Because it's not about the actual content of the education in terms of they want to make sure that people understand what's going on. They don't want them to understand that. They want them to learn what they approve of as knowledge and automatically reject any other ideas that come their way as evil, as wrong, immoral, etc. Is something that needs to be weeded out and stamped out. And this is why when I've often talked about liberal ignorance, people come up and say, liberals are the most tolerant people around. We only don't tolerate, this is within the same paragraph, you know, and it gives us the people who spread thoughts of hate. This is it. It's not the idea that you can murder somebody, not an issue. But if you're spreading thoughts of hate, just the thoughts of hate, right? And what they call, and it's not necessarily hate, it's what they define as hate. So no more free speech. You're an evil person, and you need to be gotten rid of. And this is actually in paragraphs that they feel that people who do not think like they do are evil, they have evil thoughts, that needs to be removed from society. Of course, you'll have higher up saying, well, yes, they people need to be removed from society, but they need to be reprogrammed, re-educated. And so they send you to re-education centers. In other words, prisons. This is what we saw this in the history of the Soviet Union, called the gulags. We saw what they were like. But to the mind of a socialist, history fundamentally doesn't exist. History is whatever your master tells you it is. In other words, it's an authorized history. So as long as historians agree, or scientists agree, academics agree, that's your authority. The actual content of what they agree on doesn't matter. It's simply that the scientists agree, right? Climate change, right? If scientists agree, it's now time to stop the debate on global warming, on climate change. Scientists agree, and nothing more. That's it. That's the entire argument. And you'll hear this over and over and over again. And it doesn't matter who it comes from on the left. These people say the exact same thing. Scientists agree. The debate is over. Global warming, climate change is real. And no more discussion. No evidence. Even though, why no evidence? Why not, you know, produce some evidence that this is what's going on? Why? Because most of the evidence in peer-reviewed journals has been demonstrated to be false. So there is no more scientific discussion because they don't have evidence. There is no evidence of climate change or man-made climate change, or however they want to describe it, it's really global warming. It's the same issue, they simply redefine the terms. But in their mind, they've shut all that off. All of it is now gone. They're no longer thinking, oh, this isn't real. They've convinced themselves, because others have convinced them, because the scientists agree, because the academics agree, because the politicians agree. Global warming is real. And so for the mind of a socialist, it's real and goes unquestioned. And it goes into their mantras, their chants, their songs, and they learn it by memory, without question, and without questioning their authority. They question everybody else's authority. Anyone who doesn't agree with them, they question the authority. And they come back with, well, that's just an opinion. So in other words, they're dismissing the idea and supporting their own. This isn't free thinking. This is indoctrination. This is mind control. This is the minion society. And it's not just the left that does this. And this is the whole party is watching a progressive channel, so-called progressive channel, which is fundamentally mainstream. They're pretending to be alternative, but they're not really alternative. Most of their sources come from either the New York Times or the New York Post. Highly biased views. And they simply comment on the stuff. There's no content behind it. And why? Because the guy behind it, this guy named Cenk, he's a Turk, calls himself a progressive, but if you look into his background history, he's a Muslim. He's a Sunni Muslim. And we see what the Sunnis have done in history. And this is where we get into this whole thing about Islamophobia. Islamophobia is a created view, again by the left, to paint anyone who disagrees with their point of view as being abnormal and evil. They're Islamophobic. right? But what does that really mean? Well, if you look into the history books, not really say the hook, but if you look into history, you'll find out what it means. You'll find out that if you go chart to see who has done all the global takeovers, where you've seen all these bombings, who were they? How did they identify themselves? They identify themselves as Sunni Islam. They do not identify themselves as Shia. There are two different forms. There's Shia and then the Sunni. The Sunni are the Arabs. The Shia are not. In this case, the Iranians are Shia, and they're not Arabs because they're Persians. There is an ancient society as Israel is, or as Greece is, or as India is, or as China is. They're ancient. It's an ancient culture. And Islam is simply the latest culture to come into Persia. The Persians were the Zoroastrians. It came out of there. They were at one point in time very strong, very powerful in Babylon. This is where you have the book of the prophet Daniel, or the three youths in the fire. If you go back to your biblical references and go take a look at that, and you'll see it. Although they were in Babylon, which was now formerly in Iraq, the culture, the fire that burned everybody, was Zoroastrian. It was a Persian belief. And the thing is that the Persians do have an ancient culture. You can go back into the biblical references and find them in there. But when they talk about Islamophobia, they don't talk about the differences between the Shia and the Sunni Islam, and the Sunni between the Shia and the Sunni. That's completely wiped out, and there's a reason for it. They want to tar all Muslims as violent extremists, and anyone who disagrees with this view are now Islamophobic. In other words, they're lumping everyone in together. There is no differentiation between Sunni and Shia, even though the reality through observation is, and this is what the socialist mind does, they take concepts and ideas and they work it to such a way that the ideas are paramount and are a substitute for reality. In other words, socialists create their own reality. They take a concept and create reality from it. So they don't necessarily understand what's going on all the time. This is the crossing situation we have right now. Since we're here. Okay, I'm gonna go. Even though the light's against me. See, what happens is, as I talked about before, this is, again, a socialist society here. You have a situation where walking is supposed to be the right and driving the privilege. Yet we see here the traffic light. The light was green, but it didn't have a walking sign. Why? Because the cars took precedent. I have to be at the post, press the button in order for the walking signal to show up. If I'm not there, it doesn't show up, and I don't get the cross. Particularly if it's a busy intersection and there's other people cars coming, I have to wait. But most people are good. Again, it's not necessarily the society that's the problem, the individual people in the society, but rather the ideas that are presented by politicians, that are worked on by politicians, and their so-called elite friends who are enlightened. They are the intellectuals. They rarely ever see reality. More often than not, they've created their own reality out of concept. This is the same thing with homosexuality, same thing with transgendered. These are all conceptual movements that the left, the social left, and I talk about the social left because there is a social right. These are the nationalists. and a lot of the Republicans on the right are still socialists, but they are socialists on the right. They're nationalists. And you'll hear this debate often framed in the Trump versus Clinton election, the 2016 election. There is a left and a right to socialism, although Cenk doesn't seem to think so. But then again, Cenk and his crew at the Young Turks are also the people who view the genocides that the Young Turks committed as a population exchange. And that's the term they use now. And all the socialists have agreed on it. There wasn't a genocide. It was a population exchange where millions of people just happened to die. No genocide here. Nothing to look at, nothing to see. They redefine genocide. They redefine mass murder. They redefine crimes against humanity as a population exchange. And this is the same group of minds who produced Islamophobia, homophobia, and now transgenderophobia. In other words, they created these fears. And these fears, these terms, are there to support and make sure that their concepts are viewed and accepted by their people as unquestioned reality. And because my battery is now dying, and I'm almost back, I think that's it for now. And I'm more than likely to share that this is more than enough for an episode, more than enough thought. So I'll see you, I would say two more, but in a few hours, because I will vlog outside if it doesn't rain. And I'll see you then, because I'm dripping with sweat. Alright, I'll see you then.
I am the professor. And professor of what? Professor of physics.
Oh, say, can you see?
Speech rules here at Democratic Earth.